4, I'm going to read verses 21 through 26 through 29. Mark 4, verses 26 through 29. He also said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scattered seed on the ground, night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain, first the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come." May God add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. First house I bought was in the head of Alabama. It cost me $13,500. It was right across the street from my mama. And as you might imagine, I was single at the time. That was not going to last. But we had a beautiful yard. At least half of the yard was beautiful. Most of the front yard was green and lush. It was a hillside going down. But on the other side of the driveway, it was bald and rocky and bare. And try though I might, I could not get anything to grow on that other side of this driveway. I plowed it. I raked it. I seeded it. I sodded it. I fertilized it. I did everything I knew to do and followed all the advice that everybody gave me, and nothing lived over there. Could not make the grass grow on that half of the yard. Well, we sold the house, moved on to greener pastures, we thought. And on coming back to visit my parents, I look across the street, and I notice that the yard that used to be rocky and bare and bald was now lush green. It was just as green, and maybe greener than the other side was beginning. And it was a miracle in my book, because I had done everything I could think about to make this yard produce. And so I talked to the new owners, and I said, "This is wonderful. You've actually managed to get grass to grow over there. How did you do it?" And they said, "Yeah, we kind of like not having to mow that side of the yard, so we put gravel on it so we could park over there. Next thing you know, all this grass is growing." Gravel. You all understand that, of course. The gravel stops the dirt from flowing away, stops the grass seed and everything else from washing up, gave things a chance to slow down and gather the nutrients that grass would need to grow there. But you wouldn't have thought of that. You want to grow grass? You don't spread gravel out. You spread seed. You just don't know, do you? I know a lot of you have a farming background. Some of you are doing some farming now. We are blessed to have the produce showing up in sacks on the front porch. Thank you very much. But you understand there's an element of mystery to it, isn't there? There's a point in which you don't know why this plot of ground is not growing and this one's growing fine, why this plant's doing well and that one isn't. And eventually you just say, well, it's a miracle. God is doing what God is doing. I had a friend. He was a boomerang kid, and after 30, he moved back in with his mother, who was in no condition to deal with this guy. He brought a girlfriend in that he had met at a local club. He had to make some kind of a living, so he started selling stuff out of the back door. His mother was a nervous wreck. She did not know what to do. She cried on my shoulder constantly and said, "Pastor, you gotta fix him. I'm gonna bring him in, Pastor." Okay, bring him in. This dude was scary. I was fearing for my own safety after I met her son. I could understand the problem. I mean, he gave me stink eye something fierce. He did not want to be sitting there talking to me. I did not think that this hard shell was going to hear anything that I said. I told her to get him out of your house as quickly as possible. You're not doing him any favors. You have to call the cops on him and have him evicted. The man wouldn't answer my calls. Once he understood that I had been influencing his mother, and so he threatened me, and I called the cops. I wasn't trying to save this man. I was trying protect myself from him. Today, this man's a friend. He helps to run a drug rehab center near Atlanta, Georgia. He has a beautiful daughter. His wife was one of his drugging buddies from way back. And yet both of them have been sober for more than 10 years, and both of them are respected members of the community, and both of them are certified addiction counselors. So they are doing this. And this gentleman will tell you, oh, I thank God for Pastor Joel for taking the time to talk to me, for taking the time to share the Word of God with me. And I look back, I threw more gravel on this man than seed. That's how God works, isn't it? The Lord moves in mysterious ways. We think that we've done all we can do, and we don't know that, you know, it says what? The seed. Now, what is the seed? We all know what that is. I know you do. Because earlier in the same chapter, in another gathering, Jesus told another parable, and then he stepped aside and told his disciples what it meant. A man was scattering seed, and some of the seed fell on the road, and the crows came and ate it. And some of the seed fell on rocky soil, and it sprang up in a hurry, but it had no root, so therefore it withered in the sun. Some of the seed fell in good soil, but the weeds grew up and choked it so that it didn't produce anything. And some of the seed fell in good soil, and it produced a crop, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. Let he who has ears to hear, hear. His disciples asked him, what does that mean? And he cleared it up. Well, the seed is the Word of God. The seed is your testimony. The seed is the things that you say to people. And the seed that fell on the road is like those people who receive the world, but Satan, like a crow, comes and takes the Word, and it does never takes root. And some of the people receive the Word with joy, and it grows up quickly, and they're like the people who, they're like the seed that fell on the rocky soil. It doesn't have good deep roots, and therefore it dies as soon as the sun comes out. Some of them are good soil, but they're good soil not just for the Word of God, but also for the word of this world. It said, then the seed grew up, but the weeds were the cares of this world and riches. Cares and blessings of this world grew up and choked the word out and made it unfruitful. And some of it fell on good soil, and that produced 30, 60, 100 fold. So then, in this parable, I guess it's the same thing. The seed is the Word of God. Now, I thought about the first one, and I've looked in various translations, and something that I thought might have been the case is not the seed. The farmer went to sow his seed. And some fell upon the rocks. It didn't say he spilled it upon the rocks. He accidentally threw some in the weeds. He dropped some of it on the road. No, he was sowing the seed. Sharing the Word of God in the comparison, in the metaphor that Jesus is giving us. He was sowing the seed, and he was sowing it everywhere. Give it a chance. Throw it everywhere. If you've ever seen grass growing up in the middle of the road, you know that some seed falls in the crack in the road and produces very well. Some seed grows up in your sidewalk and does very well. It may be hard ground, but it might do well. It might be where the crows can get to it, but maybe they'll miss this one. It might be in shallow soil. It might be in, you know, good dirt, grows good plants, it grows good weeds. But maybe those weeds will get pulled up before they choke it out. We are the sowers. We're the body of Jesus on this earth. We're here to share Jesus' love, Jesus' message, Jesus' teachings. We're here to share how Jesus has resolved the Scripture. We're here to share what God has done with us through Jesus Christ. That is our message. That's our message. That is the seed. We are the farmer, and we are sowing seed. And you may think that your seed is very precious. I mean, I've had seed that it was so fine, almost like dust. It was so fine, they said, you mix it with sand and then sow it. Because otherwise, it's just all going to fall in one place. You just sprinkle it. This is not the kind of seed that you planted 6 inches apart. And then when they grow up, you pull every other plant and stake it up and all this kind of stuff. This is sowing seed. And in both of these parables, Jesus uses the same thing. In another parable as well, he talks about the, the wheat and the tares, where his servant sows seed in a field, and then the enemy comes and sows wheat seeds in the field. And they said, look at the tares. Didn't you plant good seed here? He said, well, the enemy did that. And they said, well, shouldn't we pull up the weeds? He said, no, if you pull up the weeds now, you're going to be tearing up the wheat at the same time. Let them both grow together. And then at the harvest, we will pull up the weeds and burn them, and then we'll pull up the harvest and bring it into barns. In all three of those parables, Jesus is talking about the seed is the word of God, and the method of planting is to scatter. There's nothing careful about this method of planting. And nothing, the soil has been prepared and we're just to throw seed on it. And it's appropriate that this word would come up on Father's Day, but of course I know that some of you fathers are frustrated with your children or your grandchildren. You've tried your best, you've done all you could, you've tried to live a good example, you keep telling them the word of God, and somehow it just doesn't seem to take, and you're starting to think maybe they're just rocky dirt, maybe they're just weedy. Maybe the devil has come and taken the word out of their hearts. But, you know, that's not our job to figure that out. Jesus is telling us that that's what's going to happen to your seed. Two things are going to happen to your seed. It's going to fall in appropriate and inappropriate places. It's also going to be polluted with the world and with these tare seeds. But the harvester, the landowner, will take care of all that at the end of the age. Our job is not to say, oh no, you're rocky, I'm not going to give you any seed. Oh no, you've got weeds, I'm not going to give you any seed. No, our job is to scatter, is to throw, is to keep trying, is to keep going, is to keep telling. God bless you, oh, I don't believe in God. You know, when people give you that, they'll remember if you take it graciously, well, I'll pray for you anyway. And then go on to be friends with them, not walk away and shun them. People will remember that, you know, people will see your life. Let your light shine that men may see your good deeds and glorify your Father who is in heaven. People will see how we respond. But we don't give up. We don't stop talking to them about God. We don't stop telling them about our faith. We don't stop saying, well, what did you do this weekend? Oh, I went to church this weekend. I went to a singer this weekend. I did a mission trip this weekend. I worked in the food bank this weekend. It's what you did. Sowing the seeds. Pay attention to what kind of dirt you're sowing those seeds on. You're just sowing the seeds. The world, it says, is the field. The field is the world, and the harvest is the end of the age, and the seed is the word of God. And so we come into this world, and this world is what it is. We can't plow it or scrape it or scratch it or anything else. What's our job to do with this world? Throw seed on it. That's what we're supposed to do. Reach in the sack, grab a handful of seed, sling it. Take another step, reach in the sack, grab a handful of seed, sling it. What we're supposed to do with our testimony, with the love of God, with the word of God. We don't withhold it from anybody. We don't worry about where it's supposed to go or what's going to happen. You know, Paul, you can tell that Paul actually had heard of the parables of Jesus, even though he didn't have the Gospels in his day. But he used a lot of the same analogies. And here he is in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 5. This is where the church in Corinth had been saying, well, I got baptized by Paul. I got baptized by Apollos. Well, I got baptized by Timothy. And he's saying, that's not important to you. What, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed. Apollos watered it. But God has been making it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything but only God who makes things grow. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose. That is to say, they have the same purpose. And they will each be rewarded according to their own labor. For we are all workers in God's service. You are God's field, God's building. You're receiving the word in the testimony of those who came before us and wrote it down, in the testimony of our teachers and our elders and our forefathers, in the testimony of other Christians that we know. We are receiving the word. We're receiving the seed. It's good seed. Now what are we supposed to do with it? Reach in the sack. Grab a handful and sling it. The landowner will give you all the seed you can sling. He wants you to sling more of it. He doesn't want you to worry about, is it landing in the weeds? Is it landing on the rocks? Is it landing on the road? We'll give you more seed. You just share it. It's what we're supposed to do as a church, as the people of God. We're supposed to understand that it's not the skill with which we sling it. It's not because we're such good seed slingers that all this comes about, or that we take the right ground. I thought my friend was hopeless. He was not my friend. But now he's a minister of God. And he is saving lives by the hundreds. I thought that grass would never grow. But my neighbor spread gravel. And now they can't keep the grass off of it. I pray that all of us will consider what Jesus has told us in these parables. You have received good seed. Sling it everywhere. Let's start scattering seed. Amen.